On behalf of all of us participating in this panel, we would like to address our deep appreciation for inviting us to be part of the 11th Serbian Medical Diaspora Conference sponsored by the foundation of Her Royal Highness Princess Catherine of Serbia. We're especially excited to be participating in this first ever virtual conference, one that offers opportunities to connect with old friends, to create new connections, and hear from voices in the field. It seems to us that this year, it is more important than ever to gather. And today we come together to speak about mental health. We come together to speak about the psychological, social, developmental consequences that COVID has imposed on our lifestyle. Our speakers today are multinational. They're experts from mental health field coming from different parts of the world. Some of us are coming from countries of former Yugoslavia. Some of us are coming from United States, and some of us are coming from Israel. We felt it is especially important to join multinational voices as the pandemic caused by the spread of COVID-19 has affected all of us. And across all ages, young and older, and people in all developmental stages of life. So for the first time in our recent history, we're all in the same boat. And there is no overstating the precariousness of today. We're fatigued, we're anxious, we're paralyzed, and the tension between our longing for the normality of times past and fear of returning to a world we know has changed forever. So like you, and like all of you, my life has been for the past year and so under one roof, in one room, sitting on the same chair or couch or bed. And like all of us, I have been navigating as best as I know how to through these times of prolonged uncertainty. I have been so aware of all that was supposed to be, of all that I have planned to do, and learning that none of what I have planned to do is most likely going to happen. So like all of you, I have learned to live a life knowing that I can no longer plan what is ahead. I have been acutely aware of both finality, loss, and I have also opened the door and realized that this pandemic does offer new possibilities and new creations. I have been rethinking my relationships, and I have been reevaluating my priorities. Like you, I have been aware of both my fear and my resilience. And I have learned that my ability, as yours, to tolerate uncertainty has been the key to overcome the hardship that has befallen on all of us. And with this year of unprecedented uncertainty, we all understood also that having to rely on one another and asking the help that we need from one another is the key to overcoming this collective trauma. Because that's really what we have been going through this past year, and what will most certainly follow us through the next year and maybe even longer. We're all caught in what is called, in our professional language, a collective trauma. Now, collective trauma requires that we step outside of our individual coping skills, of our individual ways in which we navigate difficult times and hardships, times and times of loss and fear, and that we learn that our resilience depends tremendously on mass mutual resilience, on collective resilience. So we have learned that we need to find a way of how we need to trust each other, rely on each other, because that is one of the key determining factors of our overall well-being, and of course of our mental health well-being. And yes, with the vaccine slowly coming our way, in some parts of the world, they're speedier, in other parts of the world, they're very slow, we're all beginning to see the end of the tunnel, but we do have a long way to go. So this panel today will boldly be presenting a variety of different issues. Dr. Michal Shimai will be talking about the impact of COVID on families and individuals that have been living in poverty. She will be describing a study that she has done during COVID-19 pandemic, aiming to learn how people live in poverty, how they have coped with challenges encountered due to the pandemic. She and her colleagues have examined two parts of the pandemic. One is the emotional well-being, types of hardship and difficulties experienced by people living in poverty, special needs from the state services, and of course, ways in which these state services have responded and the sources and resources they offered. Dr. Jokić will be talking about the magnitude of the problem and the rising prevalence of depression during the COVID pandemic. She will talk about etiological factors. She will talk about acute and chronic mood symptoms. And of course, she will be emphasizing future directions and treatment that might affect the outcome. Dr. Lara Jarrett will be talking about the effect that COVID-19 has had on children, on adolescents, and she will be also talking about the effect that it has had on parents and ways in which parents have navigated through and mustered their coping skills and their resilience to be both there for themselves and also to take care of their children. Dr. Jasna Milovanović and Dr. Dave Atkins will be talking about ways in which COVID-19 has affected children and adolescents, ways in which it has affected raised their level of anxiety, depression, of course caused post-traumatic symptoms, increased substance abuse, increased suicidal ideation. And Dr. Atkins would focus a little bit more on the biology of COVID-19. He would be talking also about the drug use and ways in which the drug use, including alcohol, tobacco, cannabis, may have increased the risk of contracting the illness. And finally, our panel will close with one of the probably most important topics, if I may say so. Dr. Svetlana Simović will be talking about the effect that COVID-19 had on all of us mental health and health workers, globally and focusing, and with some focus on the effect it has on mental health and health workers in the United States. She will be talking about the resiliency factors, and she will be talking about actions that both individuals and healthcare systems did take and could continue taking to ameliorate the psychological distress. So, our hope is that this conversation today and the topics and questions we will address at the end of our session will prepare each of us and will prepare our communities to take on an important work of building bridges across many divides that this COVID-19 has created in societies all over the world. Dr. Michal Shimai, will you take on?
Thank you, Sonia. And as you all know, I'm coming from Israel, and my study was done on people in poverty living in Israel. Just at the beginning of COVID-19 in Israel, on March 2020, the Ministry of Science and Technology offered grants for researchers that study various aspects of the pandemic. This was an opportunity to integrate my two expertise, poverty and collective trauma, and do something that may help people in poverty, in addition to give me some sense of being creative during this difficult time. This study focuses on the way people living in poverty have coped with the challenges they encountered in face of the pandemic. Before describing our method and finding, I would like to share some general insights regarding research that are done in the shadow of uncertain situations, such as a pandemic. The first one refers to planning and implementing studies in such situation, which requires special flexibility due to the many unexpected changes that may occur in such context. For example, we plan to start collecting data for the first wave during or immediately after the first lockdown, which took place between the last week of March until the end of April, and for the second wave, 6 months later, having expected that the pandemic to have ended by then. However, the departments of social services were overloaded with work during the first lockdown, and the social workers couldn't recruit participants until about 1 to 2 months after the end of the lockdown. While the second wave, which we expected to be after the pandemic will be already behind us, took place shortly before and during the second lockdown on September 2020. Thus, we couldn't compare coping during lockdown with subsequent normal coping as originally planned. The second insight referred to the therapeutic effect of research in such difficult time. Based on our previous experience in studying people in poverty, we knew that they won't fill written questionnaires, and therefore it should be done as a structured interview in which the interviewer will read the question or items of a scale and will get an oral answer. Due to the required social distance, data were collected through the telephone, and unexpectedly, the participants shared, without asking them to do so, their experiences, not only to the open-ended questions, but also to various items of the scale which we used. In the second wave, some participants told the interviewers that they had missed talking to them because the interview help them to organize their thoughts and feelings. It can be assumed that some of these responses were thanks to the interviewers who were skilled social workers and created a special sharing atmosphere during the telephone interview. Another possible explanation is that social distancing restriction during and between lockdowns led to loneliness and despair, and talking to the researcher had a therapeutic effect. However, the information gathered through this informal sharing gave us deeper and broader information than the answer given only by the basic in questionnaire. As I mentioned previously, we collected data from the same participants in two waves. In the first wave, we recruited 88 participants, all of them clients of the welfare system due to life in poverty. 83 of them took part also in the second wave, which is considered a very high percentage of participation in repeated measurement. It is possible that the therapeutic effect of the structured interview in the need for social contact impacted the high percentage of participation in the second measurement. We examined four main areas: emotional well-being, measured as a level of stress, anxiety, depression, and resilience, type of hardship that were experienced on economic, social, and family levels, the specific need for state services, welfare, health education, and these services' responsiveness, and formal and informal social of support, sources of social support. In addition, social workers from Department of Social Services were asked how they perceive the pandemic's impact on clients living in poverty. I won't report on this part of the study due to the short time we have. We analyzed the data through quantitative and qualitative, mainly quantitative analysis methods. The results. The findings show that people in poverty experience increased hardship following COVID-19 pandemic. This hardship affected multiple, if not all, life spheres. First, household expenses increased. Lockdown policy restricted most household members to stay at home most of the time, leading to increased household expenses. For example, children from economically distressed families who are usually entitled to warm lunch at school had to eat all meals at home during lockdown, increases food expenses. In addition, parents commented that there was a significant increase in the amount of food eaten during the lockdown. It may be part of outcome of the stress. And it increased also the food expenses. This created hardship for the families living in poverty who typically live on a strict and small budget. Staying at home also increased the use of electricity and subsequent expenses. Reduction in the public transportation forced people living in poverty to use taxis, which are a very expensive alternative compared to the public transportation. Second, the income declined. People living in poverty usually work in less protected sectors, in types of job that do not enable online work or work from home. Instead, many work in low-skilled jobs in places that cut hours or close entirely due to the lockdown. Thus, many of the study's participants were fired or sent on temporary unpaid leave of absence. The combination of declining incomes and increases expenses created stress and increased material and emotional hardship. This hardship also led to difficulties with partners and conflict about financial issues. The third area of hardship was difficulties with children. For a long period of time during COVID pandemic, most of the children had to stay at home. Home of people living in poverty are usually small and crowded, giving little or not privacy at all. Many families didn't have computer or internet connection, therefore their children couldn't participate in online learning. The situation improved by the second wave because many children received computer from municipal authority or the state. However, the families didn't have the money need to have an internet contact. Therefore, having a computer wasn't always helping. Many parents felt they didn't have the skills to help their children with a distance learning because of their low level of education. Others didn't have time, either because they were at work or they had other children to help. Needless to say, people in poverty cannot afford help from a private tutor. Many parents felt they didn't have the means to keep children occupied during the long hours they were at home. they commented that they didn't have enough board games or electronic games for their children. Some participants reported that they had to leave very young children in the care of older siblings who were still young themselves in order to go to work. Participants reported that many conflict with partners were centered on raising the children during this difficult period. And mental health. People in poverty reported on significantly higher level of stress, anxiety, and depression, and lower level of resilience than the Israel general population. We did a comparison with a study of our colleague that had a national sample and collected data at the same time we did, using the same scales of stress, resilience, anxiety, and depression. Our multivariate analysis show that the number of material hardship increases stress, anxiety, and depression in both ways. Our finding also show that within the people, the poor population, those people that were not able to pay household expenses before and after COVID started showed a higher level of stress, anxiety, and depression and lower level of resilience compared to those people who have difficulties but were able to pay household before COVID. But their ability to pay for expenses declined following the result of the crisis created by the pandemic. Thus, we concluded that the long-term constant need to cope with material hardship results in mental burnout that reduces the ability to cope with additional unexpected challenge, such as created by the pandemic. Request for help and support. People in poverty request support from both formal and informal sources. The highest percentage of participants reported the Department of Social Services as their primary source of support. Most participants reported full or partial satisfaction from the social worker's help. This level of satisfaction was higher in the first wave than in the second one. And I think that the reason for it, that in the second wave, the social worker also was burned out. They have children at home. They have to work while their children stayed at home, sometimes without any other structured help. Most participants requested material help, such as food, clothes for children, computer, and more. Many participants expected social worker to initiate phone call to inquire about material difficulties and their psychological needs. Many participants compared the first and the second lockdown, claiming there was a substantial decline in the social worker help over time. Regarding general perceived of social support, as was measured by social support scale, show an average high level of general social support, which we really couldn't explain it because all the other things we studied was really very low, and we found very, very many difficulties during the pandemic. To sum up, contrary to the claim made by a financial consultant to the Israeli government, saying that people living in poverty were not harmed by the COVID-19 crisis because they substitute a welfare grant. Our findings show it is not true and just serves neoliberal cruel social economic policy. Such a claim is based on prejudice that people in poverty do not work or that allowance provided by the state enables the people entitled to them live in welfare and dignity. No, they don't, especially in time of health and economic crisis. I would like to end this presentation with two quotes from description that were given by two mothers. One, I have to work full time and don't have money for a babysitter. So I asked the big one, who is 8 years old, to babysit his 1 year old sister. It creates difficulties. He doesn't want to study. His behavior has changed and his grades have deteriorated. He is desperate. He spends most of the time on the telephone. He has become withdrawn. He used to be a child who got excited and liked to do lots of things with others. And that has changed. And the second quote, my daughter had COVID. We were in isolation and we suffered a lot. The children felt like they were in a prison. Our house is very small, 59 square meters, and we are 6 people. The room have no door, and it was impossible to isolate the sick girl. My children are anxious, crying all the time. My 8-year-old son said to me, Mom, my heart, it's hurt. I'm scared. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Sanya, and thank you, Foundation, for inviting us for this great mental health panel. It is really a privilege to be there, to be here today and to speak with you. So my name is Ružica Jokić and I am an associate professor at Queen's University in Kingston, Ontario in Canada. And I work in a mood disorders unit, which is a subspecialized unit for treatment resistant patients. I am going to talk today and I'm going to share my screen now with you about the impact on COVID on major depressive illness. And I'm hoping that in the next 15 minutes, we can address the magnitude of the problem and talk about etiology, a little bit about the symptoms, but then emphasize really the future directions in treatment and how these may affect outcomes. So in terms of the previous or the historical research about COVID, we know from the previous SARS infections that about a third of individuals did show some psychiatric comorbidities. And what was interesting from the SARS-1 epidemic was that the seropositivity was associated with increased rates of suicide and psychosis. And what had happened with the start of COVID back last year and with the initial investigations in China, again, the numbers were similar with about a third and more reporting psychological distress and negative emotions related to the COVID infection. Interestingly, most of the research has shown that younger adults are more likely to report symptoms of anxiety and depression during COVID pandemic. And this is clearly illustrated in this slide. And there was a dire prediction from the Academy of Medical Sciences last year saying that definitely the psychological morbidity is going to rise. I just showed some data from a study that was done in UK with the first lockdown. And the authors here found that the odds of depression were 3 times higher in people who had pre-existing chronic medical conditions, but the odds of developing the disease significantly increased in those facing socioeconomic disadvantages. So looking at the new data, what is happening right now does really confirm this prediction. If you look at this graph, the data from the NHIS study show about 11% at the onset of the pandemic and before. And look at how the numbers have increased. So January 2021, we have about 40% of people reporting problems. So this is an unpredictable, severe disease. A lot of unknowns, a lot of mixed messages coming from the media and the news, and unfortunately, the scientific communities. So how does COVID manifest itself in terms of the symptomatology, in adults in the acute and chronic stages? We're all familiar with the severe COVID infection and the direct effect of the virus causing an acute confusional state, delirium, and in a lower percentage, psychosis or mania. The cytokine storm that is talked about has shown to cause direct neuronal damage with the neurotropic effects. What is more important for us as mental health professionals is thinking about the mental health not only in the acute phases of the illness, but in people who recover and the ones that have chronic symptoms. And I just listed a few here. I would just emphasize that with the chronic COVID, fatigue seems to be a predominant symptom. A lot of people describe severe insomnia. The rate of suicide increased, and we're gonna hear more about that later. An interesting discussion came about when you talk about emotional well-being and mood disorders. So often in treating medically ill people, we talk about demoralization and how it differs from depression. People who are sick get demoralized, they're scared. Some use the word dispirited. In a group of these, and in particularly in vulnerable populations, this is going to progress into a fully blown major depressive disorder. Another concept that was readdressed during this pandemic, and it was referred when Sanya talked and then Dr. Shammai, is sort of this wellness aspect, the importance of resilience. And there is a term that I find fascinating, and that is the wellness deficit disorder. This is something that really happened and is definitely a risk for developing a full-blown depression. So some people are going to become very sick and ask for help. And the question is, why is that? We always talk about vulnerable populations. I see a lot of patients with depression, and the fear of illness, uncertainty about the future, the memories in those who have survived, about the ICU and the lonely patient in while they're sick, are tremendous. We heard about the impact of lonely depression or social isolation, the stigma that comes with it, and then the feelings that we all experienced, Sanya alluded to them, the stress, the anger, the frustration, boredom. And as we heard from the Israeli study, the economic depression is huge. And I fear that we're only about to get the full impact in the years to come. There is a lot in the literature about the increased partner violence at home, and particularly the lack of social support as one of the most important factors in triggering symptoms of depression. So I already alluded to the neuronal damage that happens with COVID. The other, trying to sort of make sense from the biological perspective, we know that there is a significant level of hypoxia in the brain during the severe illness, and it also causes the procoagulant state, significantly increasing the mortality in these patients. A lot of confusion regarding the medical interventions. They're being streamlined. There are clear guidelines now. And not surprisingly, if we consider major depression as an illness that is closely related to inflammation, then all of these additional biological factors kind of lead into the complexity of this specific population in these individuals. So the vulnerable, we heard about the poor and the lonely and people with chronic medical illnesses and previous psychological problems. So a great degree of emotional distress develops, defensive responses are reactivated, and we're going to hear more about the maladaptive behaviors that accompany such a pandemic or an illness like COVID-19. A few words as to why is COVID-19 infection different from what we've known in the past. The others were all contained and showed short-lived epidemics. And look at us in 2020, we're still fighting this illness. So it seems that there is a specific immune response. And this links, as I mentioned, into the etiology of depression that we more and more understand as, at least in part, a disorder of inflammation. An interesting point is about the lymphocytes and the activation not only of T1 but T2 cells that seems to be different. And again, the profound effect of neuroinflammation. The virus goes through the blood-brain barrier. There is a peripheral immune cell invasion, and even the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis seems to be affected, which again links in with the mood symptoms. So what happens during the recovery? I mentioned before the sleep disorder and the fatigue as the symptoms that seem to persist long after the infection. We don't know why this is happening for sure. It is probably a combination of factors, both biological and the consequences of the illness itself on different systems. I also mentioned the frequent recall of traumatic memories, how many people are going to develop true post-traumatic stress. We are going to learn about more. It seems that many present with emotional lability rather than episodes of low mood. There is an impact on cognition that is definitely worrisome. And there have been a couple of studies looking at mental processing, the effect of memory. And the bottom line is impaired quality of life. Like every chronic disease, but I would be comfortable to emphasize even more so in COVID, when untreated depression, when not addressed, there is an increased incidence of cardiovascular illnesses, stroke, diabetes, chronic pain, and cancer. This has been documented in numerous studies. There is one from 2016, 17 countries clearly indicate how important it is to treat depression. So what are the future directions? And this is the most exciting part, I think, of what I'm going to say today. There are a few studies looking at the effect of antidepressants in patients with COVID, and not only their effect on mood, but as agents that may be neuroprotective, they also decrease the inflammation and boost the immune response. So that is definitely good news. There is also a number of studies, and some are going on right now, looking at the immunomodulating medications that can act as antidepressants. I put a few agents here. We all know metformin is a very commonly used drug for diabetes, but it seems to have some immunomodulating properties, as well as some of the newer drugs like liraglutide, it's Saxenda or Victoza is the other name for this compound. So I find that very interesting. And one study that I wanted to bring up to your attention that has led now to some repeated trials is looking to the effects of antidepressants as this came about and was published actually in JAMA, is that when a particular, and this is one of the older SSRIs, fluvoxamine was used, it seemed to decrease respiratory complications. And this was a placebo-controlled study. So very, very exciting news in that regard. And I'm going to end on the positive side. Research is evolving, and we have the preliminary definitions of what is going to be the chronic COVID symptom or chronic COVID illness. We know about the neurological and also some psychiatric consequences that I talked about. So the good news is this is being addressed as we speak. Of course, we know more about the disease than we knew even a year ago. And new treatments are being developed and starting to be implemented. So ending there with some good news as to what the future might look like in terms of treatment of depression and the psychiatric consequences of COVID-19. Thank you.
Well, hello, and thank you for having me and inviting me for this conference. It is an honor to be able to speak to all of you. I'm going to give you just a brief introduction about who I am and what I do. I am board certified in adult psychiatry and child and adolescent psychiatry. And I work in a private practice, a pretty good size one that has a number of psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, and licensed therapists. My office location, and I'm explaining this because I want you to understand the nature and the type of patients that we see in the practice, is located in a very strategic location that captures patients from four states on the East Coast. We see patients from the state of Maryland, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and Delaware. And we are located in the downtown area. So we tend to have a combination of inner city population, lower socioeconomic status, and then we get a lot of patients from the suburbs who generally have a higher socioeconomic status, more educated patients. So the patient population is pretty wide range and interesting, and I'm going to talk about what we have clinically encountered with specifically, I'm going to focus on the children and their parents and how they have expressed stress to the situation and how they have coped. One of the main things that we have experienced through the pandemic is a significant increase in the demand for services. We have never been busier, to the point where we had to stop taking new patients for certain periods of time and really struggle to find therapy openings for the patients that we have taken on as new patients. So clearly there has been an increase in people's stress level and need for mental health care. I think in the beginning, especially with the children, I think the idea or the notion of not having to go to school was welcomed, and there was a little bit of a honeymoon period where kids were a little bit excited about that. And then, you know, within once things, it was becoming very clear that this is going to be, it's not a week or two or three, this is going to be sort of more persistent and consistent. And now we have to kind of adjust to all these changes in what we do day to day. That's when we started seeing more of the issues. So I'm going to mention some of the concerns that a lot of kids have presented to us with. There was definitely a huge increase in anxiety. Kids were worried about their health, but they were also worried about their parents' health, their loved ones' health, their friends' health. So there was definitely that concern. There was anxiety about school and academics, especially with some of the adolescents who were about to complete high school or were kind of in the midst of sitting for their exams, applying for colleges, because everything all of a sudden changed. A lot of the major exams got canceled. A lot of the requirements for colleges, they could not fulfill. There was a huge shift in their life. So that created a lot of anxiety. Definitely a lot more irritability presentation, depression, and a lot more behavioral issues with the younger kids. There seemed to be more and more crisis. This is an outpatient practice, and we typically don't have a lot of crisis with our patients. But it seemed like the rate and the numbers where we were getting urgent calls and need for crisis assessment were becoming more and more frequent. Academic difficulties were very problematic, especially for the kids who had special needs, the kids who had ADHD and were receiving accommodations in school, the kids with learning disabilities, the kids with autism spectrum disorders who had a lot of the structure they needed in school, a lot of the one-on-one, a lot of the interventions, this was not available for them at home. So there was definitely a pretty significant decline in their ability to function, their ability to maintain their academics, and it definitely affected their mood and the family dynamics. So there were a lot of interpersonal conflicts at home, and a lot more crises. Sleep difficulties became more problematic. A lot of the kids did not have structure at home. They did not have proper sleep hygiene. And we started seeing more complaints about sleep. And as I think a couple of you have mentioned that people started eating more. So we started seeing more weight gain, and a lot of the patients would present and complain that their medicine was making them gain weight, but then we would review with them their diet, their eating habits, and their physical activity, which was essentially non-existent because these kids were used to having after school activities, a lot of sport involvement, and now all of a sudden they're sitting at home day in, day out, in their rooms, probably in their bed, using their computers and laptops to have access to their school material. So we did see quite a bit of weight gain and some binge eating with some of the patients. The other thing that I think a lot of kids have struggled with is grief. The grief from losing normalcy, losing their freedom, their ability to be mobile, their ability to see their friends, their ability to do what they normally do. And then all of a sudden, we don't have that. And I think a lot of kids were grieving those losses, and that created a lot of sadness and adjustment disorders that we were seeing. The next thing I want to talk about is, now that we're going back, starting to go back to normal, there seems to be a new issue that we're seeing. I think over time, some children got very comfortable being home day in and day out, being socially isolated. Now that things are going back to normal, it seems that we are having issues with social anxiety, panic attacks. Kids are finding it really difficult to get back to school. They're finding it really difficult to socialize. They're very hesitant, they're avoidant. A number of kids have presented with new onset panic attacks and anxiety issues. Some kids avoided school altogether and opted to remain online because schools were providing that option. So this seems to be the new thing right now as kids are getting back into normal. I do want to mention too, and that may be kind of connected what Dr. Shamai was talking about in terms of poverty, that a lot of the inner city children really depended on meals that were provided in schools. And when kids were getting online schooling, they did not have access to the meals. So we were seeing issues because of hunger and issues about food safety, of food anxiety. So at the end of the day, though, eventually the schools were able to make some arrangements and they were actually delivering the meals to the kids in their homes, which was a nice relief for some of those children. But, you know, that I think sometimes we don't pay attention, very busy clinic to the fact that kids may have a lot of anxiety because of food insecurity. And it's important to kind of look into that and maybe try to provide them with resources or services that can help alleviate some of those things. Now, in addition, to this. So children had to deal with the stress from all these direct things that have happened to them. They've also had to deal with the indirect stress of having to deal with their parents' anxiety. So the parents have experienced similar changes, similar issues. They've had their own issues to deal with, whether it's, you know, losing a job, financial problems, or having to work from home. Not having a proper space to work, not having access to childcare. So these parents are now expected to work full-time from home, watch their children, and not have access to childcare, and also help them with their schoolwork. So parents were getting really, really stressed. And that stress tends to kind of flow between a child and a parent. And sometimes the parents are not fully aware of, you know, how their own mood and their own anxiety can create tension in children because, you know, maybe they seemingly assume that I can manage it, I'm not showing it, but children can feel those things and anxiety does go back and forth between a child and a parent. So part of working with the children is not only addressing their issues, but also trying to address the parents' issue, trying to help them manage their own anxiety, how to problem solve their day-to-day difficulties, and how to navigate that so that it's not impacting the kids as much. what we have seen sometimes is, one, the parents seem to underestimate maybe how the stress has affected the children, especially in very young children. But even young children who are not fully involved in our day-to-day things have been affected pretty significantly, and they have probably lost a good chunk of time in terms of development, specifically social development. So now these young kids are at home, they're not getting exposed to other children their age, they're not playing, they're not spending time outside, and they're using very precious time that is important for developing skills, you know, conflict resolution skills, social skills, interpersonal skills. So that is a problem for those children. And I think the parents may not have always been kind of aware of how this may be impacting the younger children, just because they feel they're more protected, they don't have to deal with the stress. The other thing is, sometimes the parents seem to be torn in terms of how permissive can I be, because this is a really difficult situation, I don't want to be too hard on the kids, but then on the other hand, you know, I want to kind of maintain structure and routine. And I think a lot of parents felt conflicted about that, not quite sure what to do. And I think it's very important to tell parents that they still need to be parenting despite how difficult this is, and help the kids cope as best as can be. So some of the things that we talked to kids about and to the parents are the very simple things that people tend to forget about. So maintaining structure and routine, you know, something that is very, very simple. We tend to do it very well when we're going to school and working. But when we're working from home and doing school from home and we're in the bedroom all day long, like a lot of the kids have been, it's very difficult not to have any structure in any routine. And this is problematic, because then these kids are, you know, they're spending more time on the internet, they're spending more time than they need to be on the video games, which has been extremely problematic. And maybe Dave, I don't know if you guys have seen this, but, you know, addiction to video games, it is becoming more of an issue. We see repeatedly the parents complain about this. Some of the other simple things that we discuss with the kids is sleep hygiene. Again, very simple guidelines. Maintain a sleep schedule. Avoid taking naps during the day. Make sure you stop using electronics an hour before bedtime. Don't drink caffeinated beverages. Get exposed to the sun in the morning. That's one thing that I find a lot of teenagers specifically are not doing. A lot of teenagers are using their bedrooms to do their schoolwork. They're in their windows closed most of the daytime, so they're not seeing the sun. And it's important for them to get exposed to the sun to regulate their melatonin secretion so that they can regulate their biological clock. Again, a very simple thing that a lot of people tend to overlook. Physical activity. Again, a lot of these kids, they're not doing what they used to do. They're not playing sports. They're not in school. They're not walking up and down the steps. They're not walking to school. They're sitting around all day long. And that tends to make them feel more tired and more depressed and put on more weight. So I ask them to do simple things. Can you help in the chores? Can you cut the grass in the backyard? Can you take a walk around the house? Take a run, walk the dog. Physical activity is, again, very, very important. The next very important piece is to stay socially connected. So in the beginning, when we had the lockdown, I would ask them to make sure that they have access to electronic devices to stay connected with their friends, preferably face-to-face, so they have that interaction. When things started improving, I did discuss with some parents, you know, you can maybe pick one or two safe friends who have good hygiene in terms of following the guidelines, and maybe have the kids get together outside in the front yard while maintaining the safe distance and wearing the masks. to help, you know, with that feeling of isolation and the loneliness. I think kids got really, really bored, bored out of their mind, not being able to be with their friends and see them and socialize. So those are some of the main things that we talk to our patients about in terms of the day-to-day activities that can help alleviate some of those issues. But again, importantly is to address, yes, this is difficult. It is a loss. And to acknowledge and validate the feeling that, how you feel is probably normal given the situation. Because a lot of them are scared, they're not sure, you know, what's wrong with me, why am I feeling this way? And it's important to validate that and at the same time treat, obviously, and provide the support that they need. Definitely, we've used a lot of antidepressants this year, many antidepressants to help a lot of the kids. And sometimes, you know, if the parents are struggling themselves, referring them to treatment too, because that's a very important part of treating the child and addressing their issues. And at the end of the day, I think despite what we have seen, and I think there will be probably a lot more that we're going to see in terms of mental health after the fact, but it seems like, again, humans tend to have a lot of resilience. The majority have coped with it in one way or another and have managed to get by. Some needed more support and more care than others. But at the end of the day, it seems like humans can be and are very resilient and that we just have to tap into that resilience to get them to where they need to be. And that is all. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Miles. I am a child psychiatrist and I work in Dallas, Texas. I work in a big urban hospital and I'm a part of consult liaison team. I also do have private practice. So I am going to talk today a little bit about the research project that I have actually been doing with one of my current fellows, Dr. Zettel. And we wanted to explore how did COVID actually impact our service. I just want to give a couple of brief remarks. We all know by now that novel coronavirus cases emerged in China in December 2019, and really first case in United States was confirmed in January in 2020. I thought it's always interesting to see the numbers, and my numbers are maybe from mid-2021 when I was preparing the presentation. So you see worldwide number of cases is nearly 164 million, and it's probably underreported because not everyone was tested, particularly in the beginning. And so far, there is a staggering number of deaths, like over 3 million people. In the United States, we had a fair share of our cases, and we had a total of 33 million people sick and nearly 600,000 dead. I think it's always really very difficult to predict pandemic, but for some reason, because no one expected that pandemic will last so long and have this huge impact on whole world mental health care workers, as well as all healthcare workers, we were totally unprepared. So of course, children are growing up in families, and pandemic affected both families and children in many, many different ways. Today, children have access to technology, and certainly during pandemic, that access was even more significant than prior to pandemic. And kids were able to communicate with their school friends. They were able to communicate maybe with their relatives through Zoom meetings, through Facebooks. However, although there was a remote communication, social contacts were very minimal, and it seems that isolation has been increasing. As we heard already, there are many reports throughout the world about increase of many psychiatric and psychological disorders in children and adolescents, anxiety, depression, substance abuse, post-traumatic stress disorder. And certainly I don't think it's hard to imagine how a child who has attention deficit disorder or oppositional defiant disorder can be very having much more symptoms in confined small place, in very close environment. There are some reports of increased violence between the families, kids abuse, as well as partners abuse. And then of course, last but not least, there are reports of increased suicide attempts, as well as suicidal ideation in children and adolescents. I'm just going to mention, because Dr. Jared talked extensively about schools, I just want to mention that schools have great importance in children's life, not only for education, which was partially impacted or lost for many kids in 2020, but schools also provide social interaction, emotional connections. In many cases in the United States, children get not only their free meals through schools, but also their mental health services. And also school provide environment to interact with teachers, kids interact with social workers, with school nurses, maybe with police officers. So they learn how to interact with authority figures, and that part was also lost. So impact on education, I think, will just be remain to be seen in years to come. Kids had less school and then more access to all kinds of electronics, which means that they were staying on playing games and online for many, many hours. That also led to loss of sleep routine. Sleep became very irregular. And then of course, since parents were frequently working from home, it was really hard to supervise child and also do your own work. So there was significant loss of regular routine, as well as decrease in physical activities, as many families were confined to their apartment. So keeping all this in mind, we wanted to see what was impact of this new pandemic last year on my service. Consult liaison service is, as you all well know, very specific service. We provide mental health services on medical floors, and I work in big urban hospital with more than 600 beds in Dallas, Texas. We also provide services for emergency room. However, our data, we are able to collect data better for our medical floor services. So we see patients who were admitted to medical floors after suicide attempts with suicidal ideations. And then of course, a lot of patients with anxiety, with bipolar, with psychosis, substance abuse, like really wide variety of patients. So we divided patients we have seen into groups. One group of patients were seen from January 2017, 18 and 19 till December 2019. And then we have second group of patients of data we collected in 2020. I do have to say that I'm pretty convinced that last year was very specific. So what we see in here probably will change in 2021. And I'm sure that numbers will be even higher, because last year, due to significance and severity of disorder, many families were not even bringing children to the hospital, even if the need was great. So pre-COVID, my service saw on medical floors 1,380 patients, and then during COVID, 469, and there was slight difference. A majority of our patients, as you can see, is female, like nearly 65%, and males constitute like 35%. Although we see patients ages from 2 to 18 years, most of our patients, average age actually for our patients was 14.3 years. And I didn't put all numbers, I apologize. In pre-COVID era, we have seen actually 691 patients who attempted suicide. And then during the COVID past year, we have seen 257. And then in 685 kids had suicidal ideation, and during COVID year, 255. So once they did the statistics, it didn't seem that, although we have seen somewhat more patients, it didn't seem that number of suicidal ideation or suicide attempts actually changed. However, then our statistician reviewed like many disorders, including depression, anxiety, PTSD, psychosis, autism, eating disorder, ADHD. And we came up with really interesting data. I think it's very interesting. There was significant difference in pre-COVID and COVID number of depressed kids who attempted suicide or who had suicidal ideations. Two other groups, I think maybe we didn't really expect to see this result. So patients who have attention deficit disorder had significant increase in suicide attempt as well as in suicidal ideation. Adjustment disorder as well, we included in adjustment disorder with anxiety, conduct disorder, and then adjustment with depression. And you can tell that number of suicide attempts in these three diagnoses actually also was significant. We are still trying to figure out what is the difference in, what was actually the increase in specific diagnosis. And it seems that we have seen increase in patients with depression, and then most likely patients with eating disorder, but they're still trying to figure out this data. As I said, I think if we are able to collect data for 2021, I'm pretty certain that numbers will be even more even more impressive. And then I guess we have to follow and see what is the change or an impact on mental health in years to come. With that, I will conclude my presentation. Thank you.
All right. Well, I'm just going to go ahead and present then. My name is Dr. David Atkinson, and I am here covering the effects of substance use during the COVID crisis. And I work at UT Southwestern and Children's Hospital with Dr. Miles. And I thank you all for this opportunity to present to you guys today. So there are my disclosures, no conflicts of interest for this presentation. Just wanted to go over the background a little bit. As has been mentioned before, anxiety and depression during the pandemic are important factors in how they may affect youth behaviors, et cetera. I think that social isolation leads to anxiety and depression. Chet Byrne did a study on that. We have also seen that many different addictive-like behaviors are increased. For example, increased junk food, increased screen time was noted in a recent French study. The other thing is that a study in China very early on demonstrated that more electronic entertainment in kids led to more anxiety and depression. So that's interesting, is that electronic entertainments may not just be an effect of the pandemic, but may also be a cause for more mental health harm. Older kids seem more depressed than younger. Regular physical exercise protected against anxiety and depression. The reason why this is important is that substance use trends oftentimes play off of changes in behaviors, changes in anxiety and depression. Social distancing for young people was a double-edged sword during this pandemic. So COVID-19 caused unprecedented loneliness and boredom for a lot of adolescents, and some adolescents showed an increase in the amount of family bonding, and many decreased their substance use due to the social distancing requirements and due to the fact that they were less interactive with peers. Some adolescents, though, increased their substance use. An adult female study showed that moderate and high-risk drinking actually increased during the lockdown, whereas very casual social drinking, low-risk drinking decreased. The number of abstinent adults increased, and we saw something similar with benzodiazepine use increased. A Polish study showed that the alcohol consumption increased specifically in 18 to 24 year old age group. Overall, teens used more cannabis during the pandemic. They also had more problematic video gaming, as a study by Zhu recently came out, demonstrated is that, if you don't have access to the drugs, you don't have access to the friends, addictive behavior still may find an expression. And video games is one of those ways that it often took place. It's a safer activity than some other things during the pandemic, but it still has its long-term consequences. And now, one of the interesting things about the cannabis users is that 23.6 of adolescents who use cannabis were still using face-to-face during lockdowns. These are times when people were not supposed to be visiting others outside of the home. And I think that basically a very large study by Turna from a Canadian data set showed that alcohol and cannabis use increased greatly among youth. Not so much among adults. Among adults over 60, it actually decreased. One of the reasons why we're so worried about these changes in substance use is the effect that the substances may have on the biology of COVID and how substance use problems could increase risk. Teens and preteens from age 10 to 19 generally have a 16-fold lower risk of COVID-19 mortality than adults age 20 to 29. This is possibly related to a relatively robust innate immunity, and they also have lower expression of ACE2 receptors. And the expression of ACE2 and TMPRSS2, which is used to cut the coronavirus between S1 and S2 subunits of spike and is a very important factor in increasing infectious potential, those enzymes are expressed in higher levels when people smoke. So we know that there's an increased vulnerability for this among smokers. The other thing that cannabis can do is it can basically disrupt interferons and interleukins. Those are among the first lines of defense against SARS-CoV-2. And cannabis is shown to decrease antiviral immunity through interferon and interleukin pathways being disrupted and suppressed. Data from COVID patients in Wuhan, this is all adults, not so much kids, but did reveal a 14-fold increase of COVID-19 progression in individuals with a history of smoking compared to non-smokers. Respiratory infections, including COVID-19 now, in other studies have been shown to be strongly associated with smoking. Respiratory infections have been tied to vaping in the past, and a recent study using mice showed that doing a vaping apparatus to simulate vaping in mice led to worsening progression of COVID-19 infection among these mice. And so the question is, does it increase your risk of contracting COVID to vape nicotine? Well, it does increase your ACE2 expression. Also, it is unknown how big of a deal this is, but we know that sometimes people are sharing vapes, and oftentimes when they are vaping together, they are doing so in a close proximity, partly because it's a social activity and partly because they may be huddling together to avoid detection. Cannabis, of course, has been shown to contribute to immunosuppression. We know that it leads to increased risk of lower respiratory tract infections. It reduces the cytokines, IL-17, IP-10, and inhibit antiviral interferon responses. Cannabis smokers are also shown to have deficient cytokine production and deficient alveolar macrophage responses that are not seen in tobacco smokers. So cannabis may have a specific risk that goes beyond the risk that you would see in tobacco. The other major factor that has happened in America, and I call this the American horror story, is what's happened to drug overdose during the pandemic. The first wave of lockdowns in the USA coincided with startling increases in the rate of fatal drug overdoses. No jobs, no rhythm of daily life, together with increased anxiety, boredom, a sense of defeat. The 35 to 44-year-old age group was most at risk for an overdose death. And there's some question in the data, but it seems that overdose deaths have trended younger during the pandemic. 88,000 drug overdoses in the United States occurred in the 12-month period from August 2019 to August 2020. That's the highest rate ever recorded. And I think that this is up from about 70,000 in the previous 12-month period. So we're looking at a substantial increase. So when it comes to the synthetic opioids such as fentanyl, 37 of 38 territories with data on synthetic opioid overdose rates noted an increase in the overdose from fentanyl and related compounds. Overall, there was a 38% average increase. So it may not just be the pandemic, it could also possibly be that synthetic opioids such as fentanyl are substituting for heroin in the United States drug supply. Cocaine overdoses increased as well though, so we can't just blame this on fentanyl. 23% increase in fatal cocaine overdoses. So what do you do with an adolescent who's using during the pandemic? And this is where I'm gonna go over a very brief overview of treatment. So how do we treat adolescent substance use? There are several modalities. First, cognitive behavioral therapy, motivational interviewing, and then something called MET-CBT, which is motivational enhancement therapy combined with a CBT. Motivational enhancement therapy is a manualized form of motivational interviewing. It's rather easy to do. Family therapy and especially family behavioral therapy are important. And also contingency management, where the adolescent can earn positive reinforcers for clean drug screens. So the model for adolescent behavior change, whether it's substance or any other behavior, is that you focus on the behavioral intention through five factors. First is the expected value of the behavior. Second is the self-efficacy. How sure is the adolescent that they can do this behavior? Third, you want to focus on the perceived norms of the behavior. What do other adolescents my age do? How normal is my behavior for my group that I identify with? And then that ties into self-image. Who is the person I want to be? Who do I see myself as? And how does this behavior, whether it's taking precautions against COVID or using substances, how does it fit in with my self-image and identity? And then affect, which is the emotional experience that are associated with the behavior. So motivational interviewing tries to intervene on all of these. It attacks perceived norms by beginning with an assessment and feedback for the adolescent. Telling them you are using more than 88% of the adolescents your age helps them understand that what they're doing is not exactly normative. But it emphasizes autonomy. Only you can make this decision. The doctor cannot make you change. Your parents can't make you change. We can encourage your parents to set limits that might make you change. But basically, you are the only one who can make this decision. You also want to strengthen the adolescent's own reasons for change, their own reason for cessation of substances. Rather than giving them what you think are the most rational reasons, pick up on the reasons they have, no matter whether you think they're the most important or not. You also want to work on their self-image, and you want to develop a discrepancy between these ideals they have for themselves and their substance use. So you want to be an astronaut. Well, how does using cocaine affect your dream of being an astronaut? You know, you want to be a veterinarian. How does using marijuana every day affect your goal of being a veterinarian? Or you think of yourself as a supportive influence on your younger sibling. How does your substance use affect that? You want to enhance the emotions that drive change. Even if some of those emotions are painful, you may, you know, choose to enhance those. But I think that we also want to enhance the enthusiasm for the things they could do if they're sober. That is, you know, getting a job, playing sports, studying more, going to college. Motivational interviewing studies have been done, and the adolescent cannabis checkup was one great intervention that had two sessions of motivational interviewing with youth, and then one optional session for those who chose a third session. The interesting thing is, even those adolescents who refused the optional session, they still had an improvement based on that motivational interviewing intervention above simple psychoeducation about substance use. These motivational interviewing recipients had a greater change in their substance use. Brief motivational interviewing, a nice study showed that 15 minutes at a primary care clinic can reduce alcohol and marijuana problems a year later. Multiple studies show that just two sessions beat standard of care. Of course, to do motivational interviewing, you need to get trained for that, but there are several trainings that are currently available online all around the world. I don't know of any in the Serbian language, but that's something the Motivational Interviewing Network of Trainers may help you. Enhancing the power of therapy is contingency management. And so this is where you do drug screens on the kid, but not to get them in trouble, to give them a reward. So you can have drug screens shipped to the house, ordered online. If the parent can't figure it out, they can photograph that drug screen and send it to the provider. And this is where you get what we call voucher-based incentives, or basically able to earn gift cards, gift certificates to certain restaurants, stores of their choice. And this is where they can earn something positive to replace the drug. You give escalating rewards. We start out at a level of $10, and it goes all the way to $50 after 10 weeks of continuous abstinence. This really helps motivate their participation. And if they relapse, they can go back, you know, like they go back and then the next week they'll have another chance to earn that gift card level. But if they've worked their way up to 30 and then they relapse 2 weeks in a row, then they would go back to 10. They would start over. This is incredibly important for this reason. If you look at the difference with motivational interviewing in the 4 week time period, it's not very good. But look at what it does in the 10 week abstinence time period. If you want to motivate sustained abstinence, you use contingency management, you use positive reinforcers to get them excited about sobriety. There are some family interventions, such as family behavioral therapy, that are very effective. And those work on using positive reinforcers and consequences. They work on setting limits. They also work on improving communication. They work on helping the teen or the parent set clear expectations of behavior for the teen. You also want to decrease the negative emotions that you express. Furthermore, drug screens are one of the ways that you can work on this, but drug screens do not work on their own because you have to have other ways to monitor their behavior as a parent. Otherwise, they will just learn how to game the drug screens. So those are some references. I have a set of references online, and thank you for your attention.
Hello. hello, everyone. And I also very much appreciate being invited to present at this conference. I am a psychiatrist and a psychoanalyst in private practice in Minneapolis, Minnesota. I came to United States to train, and I completed adult and child and adolescent psychiatry training at Mayo Clinic in Rochester. And then I completed psychoanalytic training here in Minnesota. I spend my time seeing patients in my private practice and also teaching and supervising residents at the University of Minnesota at Mayo Clinic and at Hennepin County Medical Center. And then also I teach psychoanalytic candidates at Minnesota Psychoanalytic Society Institute. And today I am talking about the effects of COVID on mental health of healthcare professionals globally, and then a little bit more specifically in the United States. I will review the factors, risk factors for psychological distress in healthcare workers, individual resiliency factors, and then actions that both individuals and healthcare systems can take to ameliorate psychological distress. As previous presenters have talked about, we are all aware of how COVID pandemic affected everyone. And specific population, I think, is healthcare providers. COVID had and continues to have an extraordinary negative effect. And I tend to talk about it with my patients as this ongoing catastrophic event, sort of a natural disaster. But natural disasters, they end eventually. Ground stops shaking after an earthquake, water recedes. And with this sort of disaster, whether it's natural or, you know, now you're wondering if it's coming from laboratory, it is not... It lasted for more than a year, or it's more than a year. You can't see the contaminant. You can't see the enemy. It's all around. Information about the pandemic is changing, about the virus, about protections, about personal protective equipment. And so it doesn't cease. It doesn't stop. When something is done after an earthquake, the community can come together, organize, reorganize, rebuild, grieve. And here it's kind of, we are all in the process. We cannot really do that as healthcare professionals because the pandemic is still going on. I'm going to share my screen, and let me see how can I do that. Share content. Perfect. All right. Let's go to the next slide. Washington Post published in April of 2021 an article titled "Burnt Out by the Pandemic: 3 in 10 Healthcare Workers Consider Leaving the Profession." About 6 in 10 say that the stress from the pandemic has harmed their mental health. Now, this has been a real significant concern in the United States. And we'll go to the next slide. This is data from up to date, from April 2021. I presented data here just in a table, just for visual orientation. But the data are from different sources and different studies around the world, from the US, China, Italy, and Canada. And the numbers are quite concerning. We have here symptoms of distress and or psychiatric illness, anxiety, depression, insomnia, acute traumatic stress, secondary trauma, which we are talking about healthcare workers and their exposure to trauma through secondary trauma, and then general psychological distress. And I've kind of plotted some values that I found for healthcare professionals, general population, patients with COVID, and then children. And you have heard 2 earlier presentations about, you know, incidences of these disorders in children more thoroughly. So let's go back to the previous slide, just a little more. It's interesting that anxiety and depression are quite significant in the US compared to other countries. And also acute traumatic reports of acute traumatic stress disorder and general psychological distress compared to, let's say, Italy, China, and then I'll comment on Singapore. And so it is interesting for us to consider, I don't have the data why the difference, but is this something cultural, individual, system related, is it under or over reporting? For one set of data, there is a hypothesis that the lower rates of PTSD reported in Singapore are attributed to better preparedness of physicians and healthcare system due to previous experiences with SARS, SARS epidemic in 2003. So we can go to the next slide now. Risk factors for psychological disturbance can be internal and or external, so to speak. They are, of course, closely interwoven and not easily separated. But for the purposes of a more systematic review, as well as outlining some more pragmatic approaches of how they can be addressed and ameliorated, they're divided here on internal and external. Internal would be something like a previous history of psychiatric illness, insecure attachment style, both anxious, preoccupied, and anxious dismissive. And then primary personality structure, those are primary coping strategies, the ego strength, and so forth. And then external would be related to the place of employment, to family circumstances, and then to social, economic, and political issues, so to speak, factors outside of one's person. In almost all major risk factors for psychiatric problems in healthcare professionals have been found in almost all studies to be, number one, intensity and frequency of contact with patients with COVID. So that was the major risk factor. Really significant factor close to this exposure to sick patients was prior history of psychiatric symptoms and of general medical illness. And psychiatric symptoms or disorders that are major risks would be anxiety, depression, insecure attachment, recent trauma or loss, living alone, and being primary caretaker for others. Another major risk factor was fear of infecting family members in household or spending time isolated from family because of the risk of infecting them. And for those who live alone, loneliness due to isolation was another major factor. Feeling that one is left to one's own devices in terms of personal protective equipment, professional guidance, and general well-being, that is perceived lack of organizational support or support from supervisors, feeling that leaders care more about the financial bottom line, legal issues, or their own positions more than for the organization, their employees, or patients. Let's look at the other, yes. Additional risk factors as a source of anxiety, depression, and trauma in healthcare professionals. Significant was lack of, as I mentioned, I mentioned in a previous slide, lack of personal protective equipment and concerns about reprimands for speaking about equipment shortages. And this has been a really big kind of issue here in the United States with news news outlets reporting on physicians or nurses being fired for speaking about inadequate personal protective equipment or inadequate infection control and so forth. The further would be inconsistent and contradictory messages and directives regarding medical setting and public health care measures, such as it's okay to wear a mask, it's not okay to wear a mask, you don't need surgical, you don't need N95, what is needed. You need the face shield. It seems that these inconsistent messages that were sometimes guided by availability of resources were an issue. Lack of transparency and clarity in communication from leadership, and then punitive messages from leadership were additional risk factors. Lack of enforcement and infection control procedures in the workplace. I have had many patients who are physicians who kind of came with this concern because they were really highly anxious about this. Increased workloads, as many physicians have experienced and many nurses and other clinicians undertaking unfamiliar clinical duties with insufficient preparation. Due to crisis and physician shortage, many physicians were covering units that they're not familiar with, practicing outside the scope of their practice, feeling out of their depths, lacking confidence and fearing that they will harm the patient, make a mistake. Physicians in particular are not do well with uncertainty and unknown. And there has been a lot of uncertainty due to the lack of treatment guidelines for COVID, and this has been really an issue. And then, of course, reluctance to seek psychological help because of the concerns about stigma of mental health. And I think this is present on a global level, not just in the United States. I believe that is present quite a bit in Serbia. And then here, problems with licensure and certification. If one reports having been treated for mental illness. And so those are all kind of significant additional factors. Moral dilemmas and moral injury arising from situations such as deciding how to allocate insufficient resources and as a result of these scarce resources, placing other patients in danger and implementing clinical decisions made by others that one thinks are contrary to best practices. This first point essentially talks about the concept of moral injury that I'll talk just in a minute. It's a relatively new term in healthcare, and it is an observed phenomenon that is a result of systemic issues. I'll talk more about that. What are some other factors? Feeling disconnected from patients and their families due to personal protective equipment. This has been an issue for many clinicians, and they started in many places, they started wearing their photographs on their uniform for the patients to be able to see their face. Many providers are so exhausted and burnt out emotionally, it's difficult to provide emotional support to patients that they used to do. Feelings of helplessness, worthlessness, and guilt about poor patient outcomes, fear of becoming sick and then not being able to help out colleagues or infecting others, and then encountering a large number of patients' deaths, including the patients dying alone without the presence of the family because of the quarantine measures, and then grief-stricken families that providers need then to inform about the death. There are factors that impede help-seeking behavior in healthcare workers, and they impede getting mental help. Those are perfectionism, stoicism, and self-reliance. And these are often present in healthcare professionals, fortunately or unfortunately. I want to mention concept of burnout. It is a syndrome characterized by a high degree of emotional exhaustion, dissatisfaction with one's accomplishments at work, and depersonalization. It occurs in the context of chronic job-related stress and including medical practices. It was defined in 1975, the term, by the term for other fields, but has been borrowed from these other fields and applied to medicine. It's described as malaise, fatigue, frustration, cynicism, and inefficacy that arise from making excessive demands on energy, strength, or resources in the workplace. It is not synonymous with depression. Symptoms may also include dysphoria and suicidal ideation. And the burnout has been quite a topic in the United States in the recent years and has been one of the major struggles among physicians. Now, the concept of moral injury is a relatively recent concept. It stems from a broken or defective healthcare system. Moral injury in medicine occurs when clinicians are expected in the course of providing care to make choices that transgress their long-standing, deeply held commitment to healing. And it has been discussed as an occupational hazard in medicine before, a few years before COVID pandemic. And it describes position where professionals with highly skilled and the responsible jobs work, but progressively lose due to kind of structural changes, their autonomy, authority, and agency in performing their jobs. Moral injury can contribute, but is not the same as adjustment disorder, traumatic stress disorder, depression, and so on. So it is not a mental illness. It is not a disorder. It is a phenomenon. We can go to the next slide. Now, what helps us as individuals? Those are factors of resilience. What are the central factors of resilience for an individual? And broadly speaking, they are a sense of relatedness, capacity for self-reflection, and a personal sense of agency. And these are, we can stay a little bit longer with this slide because I would like to say a couple of words about each. We come to workplace with these, kind of with our personal traits or with these senses and capacity, but if we we can also work on those. Relatedness, I want to say, is ability to feel connected to others, to empathize with others, ability to put oneself in others' shoes, and also in return to feel understood by another person, and to feel togetherness with people. In this case, for healthcare providers, would be togetherness with their colleagues. As a result, we feel understood, seen, valued, and cared for, and we have someone to go to when we are in distress. And I'm drawing here a lot from attachment theory and trauma theory. The capacity for self-reflection is ability to think and observe one's own thinking and feelings. It is being able to observe patterns of how one thinks and responds. And it also requires curiosity about our own mind and what motivates us. And so the ability to accurately self-reflect comes from childhood and early stages of life, but can also be developed to a degree. It can give oneself a sense of mastery over oneself, and then a greater understanding of why and why we react a certain way and why we do certain things. And also what we really want and need, and it can lead to greater freedom in choosing what we do, and allows us to reflect and then act rather than to react. The sense of agency or personal agency is an internal feeling or an internal sense or being able to direct one's own life, at least to some degree. There are situations where we all feel we have no control over things. We are talking here about this more generalized hovering sense that ultimately one is able and will be able to influence their own life, to contribute to society and to feel valued. I would point here that high levels of altruistic acceptance of risk during the outbreak were associated with lower levels of depressive symptoms and overall trauma, such as I want to help the patients and I accept the risk. Let's go to the next slide. I'm going to talk here about institutional protective factors or something that the medical institution have that's present at the system level because of how organization is set up and run. That would be sufficient access to personal protective equipment, supportive peers, camaraderie, spirit of camaraderie and respect, access of to mental health resources and minimizing stigma associated with seeking mental health. Trust in institutions' infectious control measures. Now, I want to say trust is not just about how institution controls infection, but that the leadership of the institution has best interest of patients and staff in mind. And then confidential and competent mental, getting confidential and competent mental health resources that the organization gives in this information freely, makes a list of local therapists who can see people confidentially, list of online resources, et cetera. Receiving clear communication from supervisors and otherwise there is no trust. And then receiving adequate time off from work. Let's go to the next slide. Now, how do we address risk factors? How can we mitigate them and foster resiliency? And the, how can we approach helping healthcare workers in psychological distress? I listed here some psychological first aid most important factors. For institutions, those would be to provide individual safety, both physical through protective equipment and psychological. Frequent breaks and time off. This is sometimes very hard to do because of the physician shortage, nursing shortage, etc. But to the best of ability, time off should be granted. Fostering sense of connection through even virtual meetings, timely and transparent communication from management about decisions, and then rationale for these decisions. Providing employees with psychoeducation, which is really important, and then mental health resources. Forming consultation groups, if feasible, and also ethical consultation groups and palliative care consultation groups. Promoting sense of agency and meaning and purpose in employees. Giving healthcare workers as much autonomy as possible in their work, and basically acknowledging if this autonomy is temporarily suspended because of the new regulations or new rules. Leadership should strive to acknowledge difficulties even if they do not have current solutions, immediate solutions. And the communication should be transparent and authentic. Otherwise, it may result in the sense of being, in employees in, of the sense in being, of being not respected or not taken seriously. And then of course, we should monitor individual clinicians in high distress who may need additional support or additional referrals. So these are some of the kind of things that institutions can do on institutional level. Let's see now what an individual can do for themselves. So we can go to the next slide. Some kind of major aspects are self-care, including body-mind strategies, then psychotherapy, getting psychotherapy, and ultimately, if all else, if nothing, no psychotherapy more formally is available, self-help books, online resources in psychoeducation. So people have already commented on earlier in the session of how rhythm, maintaining rhythm is important. And keeping schedule is crucial in the times of pandemic, disasters, wars, and so forth. Issues, mind and body are connected. And from trauma research, we know about the body-mind connection. And if you haven't read, check out The Body Keeps the Score by Bessel van der Kolk. It is important to maintain sleeping, eating, moving your body, bowel habits. Don't forget to breathe. Breathing is very important and one of the quickest way to calm and ground oneself. And it requires practice though, but there are online tutorials on how to do some deep relaxing breathing. Take breaks as much as possible, stay interpersonally connected with friends and family virtually, if anything. Perhaps self-check in about, am I drinking more? Are people who are smoking or using other substances, is the substance use increased? And then observing also for lack of certain feelings, like I'm not feeling this anymore. The last 3 months I've not felt this, or I'm feeling this more often. So these are all indicators that something might be off. We should be able to identify professional and personal support network, whether that's one person or more. And then I want to emphasize play. Adults need to play too. Play is one of the seven major currently described motivational factors, previously called DRIVE. So do play. We are talking here about games, hobbies, virtual conversations with friends, creating playful challenges for oneself, engaging in fantasy through books and movies. And engaging in fantasy is not always an escape, and escape is not always an unhealthy coping mechanism. It can be quite replenishing. There is actually a recent article in Lancet talking about factors improving quality of life in terminal cancer patients. And the study found that watching optimistic and uplifting Disney movies, except Bambi. Bambi has themes of trauma and loss. Improved mood and sense of well-being equally, if not better, than some more complicated or complex interventions. This makes us think about the power of fantasy and play and hope, essentially hope, in one's psychological well-being. Other body-mind strategies would be exercise, yoga, meditation, mindfulness practices, breathing exercises, and then psychotherapy. Of course, as a psychoanalyst, I would recommend psychotherapy to everyone, not just to address problems, but overall for personal growth and as well. I can't emphasize this enough. Pandemic warrants us using any type of psychotherapy that is available, essentially, and combining them, whether that's supportive, CBT, DBT, interpersonal, and so forth. Supportive therapy can provide problem solving, validation, listening. Psychoeducation can provide information, destigmatize mental health issues, and normalize feelings and experiences. Cognitive behavioral therapy can address cognitive distortions, catastrophizing, black and white thinking. And then psychodynamic and insight-oriented therapies can address more ingrained issues and facilitate personal growth, and they require more long-term. Supportive and cognitive behavioral therapy interventions can be used right away, quicker. They can offer pragmatic approaches, and we can use psychodynamic principles to inform our understanding of the problem and to modify and guide approaches. And of course, so the good thing is that we can actually work on ourselves, and we can grow and expand, and we can do it either on our own or with others, in therapy. The important thing is that we should exist as individuals outside of our work. This is extremely important for healthcare providers, healthcare workers. We should work on developing a sense of self that is not solely tied to medicine. And this includes hobbies, learning and developing other skills, focusing on friends, family, and then working on a sense of purpose that is, again, not solely attached to professional achievement or results at work. Being helpful to somebody else will come naturally to many healthcare providers. Being of help to a friend or a neighbor, a family member, or to a cause or to an organization, or creating something which is making, it can be making art, making woodwork, pickling, making pickles, jam, tending to a garden or a potted plant. And the nice thing is that there are so many tutorials available online on how to do things. If circumstances don't allow for actual psychotherapy with a skilled therapist, then almost anything is better than doing nothing. Reading self-help books, online apps, wellness apps, and so forth. Let's see the next slide. And this is just a tidbit of information from an online survey of clinicians in New York City from April last year, found what coping behaviors they used. And you can see here what physicians preferred. Exercise, psychotherapy, yoga, religious or spiritual practices, meditation, and some did virtual support groups. And then let's see the last slide. What can institutions do? Well, we have talked, I'll kind of let you read through the slide, but be sure not to overburden employees with, you know, we all want employees to be well, but employees can be overburdened with wellness plans, questionnaires, and so forth. So excessive wellness interventions that take time from busy employees are really a problem. And then do pay attention to communication. Communication has to be clear, and the clear communication, honest, really grows trust. And that is hugely important. And that the work culture, the good news is that work culture can be changed. The change is sometimes slow, but it can and does happen. So I'll wrap up here. I have a list of references at the end, and you can look them up.
Well, thank you so much for lovely presentations. I think they were all very informative, and I hope maybe next year we can meet in person. I think the themes and topics you chose this year was reflecting our reality and were all very well presented. So thank you so much. I would like to ask, maybe leave some time to ask a couple of questions. And in sake of time, I think we are going to ask three questions. So please think about what you would like to know a little bit more. I personally would like for someone to answer what is the role of balance and routine in child development, and how can a parent monitor use of video games, and how does that tie in routine? And I think out of all experts, maybe Dr. Atkinson would be the person to answer this question.
Well, thank you. I think that the one of the most important things about coronavirus is to remember is that it disrupted everyone's life, and not just the kids, but also the parents. Some of the parents actually had their ability to monitor the kids greatly reduced because the kids were at home and not in school, and they ended up playing a lot more video games. So parents do need to set expectations about when you would play video games, when you would not do it. I know in the first week of the pandemic, it got so out of hand in Italy that their entire internet infrastructure had slowed down because of kids gaming online. And so it interfered with smart working and telehealth. You know, and that's something that could happen anywhere. I think that what we want parents to be able to do is to set firm and effective limits that are clearly communicated to the child about video games. The video games were played excessively among a great number of youth. In fact, 21% of youth in a Hong Kong survey showed excessive playing of video games. And at the same time, with other social outlets restricted, it seems that it could be a positive social outlet for youth as well. So an absolute prohibition on the video games doesn't make sense, but more of a structured routine, getting it out of the hours of the school day, having a limit on how much is played, and encouraging youth to play online with friends, people they actually know.
To make it a little bit more social, interactive. Do you have perhaps the time limit you would recommend for parents to use, if possible? I know this is a very difficult question.
Outside of lockdown time, I set a pretty pretty strict limit of 1 hour during the week and 2 hours on the weekends. Some people may feel like that is insane. It's way too little. But I would say that the upper limit is, even during pandemic time, I wouldn't want to see anybody playing more than 3 hours. Okay. If they feel bored, they will find an interest to fill up that time. Boredom is not a fatal symptom.
Yes, I think as mental health care providers, we all applaud your recommendation. I think it's very pertinent. Well, do we have any other questions? Dr. Jared, well, you are muted, Dr. Jared.
Yes. Yes, I do have a question on maybe a topic that we didn't quite touch on, but I think is very important. And that's, I think there has been an increase in the rates of violence, and especially intimate and partner violence. Would anybody like to kind of make any remarks on that topic?
I would like.
Dr. Mikhail.
Go ahead.
In our study, we found that more than 21% report on verbal violence. So it started with a conflict and it turned out into verbal violence, calling each one names or trying to describe how the other one is bad, crazy, irresponsible, etc., etc. But it was perceived as a verbal violence, and it was also perceived by the children as verbal violence because everyone was at home and everyone exposed to this violence. In our study, only 3% reported on physical violence, but I think that the reason for it is, first of all, the small number of our sample, and the small number of people in our sample that was living with a partner. Many of them were divorced.
Yeah.
But in Israel, we heard from centers and clinics that focused on intimate violence and on family violence, that were many, many people that approached the place talking about violence, intimate violence at home, or violence between parents and children and children and parents. Yeah. So it really became one of the most difficult problems on family life during COVID.
Yeah, I think it probably can translate to many other countries. I don't think it's specific to Israel because there are studies coming from a lot of other countries showing similar results. As I said, we can continue our discussion for many hours, but unfortunately we have time for one more question. So
I would like to ask a question. Yes, thank you. I would like to, I'm curious when Dr. Jared was talking about her experience treating children in the community, what was your impression about children's reactions in terms of, like, how was it treating children virtually? What was better? What was worse? What were your observations?
Yeah, it definitely was very interesting and a steep learning curve for us and for the kids. But and the reactions were variable. However, in general, it seemed like the teens were quite comfortable with it. It's definitely their forte. This is what they're good at doing. They were definitely, for the most part, more relaxed, frequently sharing, you know, things like showing me their bedroom or their house or even their pets. Pets were a big part of the visits in many occasions. However, with the younger kids, especially children who have behavioral problems and ADHD, yeah, it was a little bit more of a struggle. And in many visits, it was just very easy for the kids to not even participate or leave the session because they just simply can. So there was a little bit of a struggle there trying to get them in front of the screen when they're kind of resistant to that. So it was a little bit of a mixed experience. And we still have more to learn.
Yeah, I feel in some cases, if I may make a comment on this, I feel sometimes, especially teenagers, didn't have enough privacy. And I loved, because I did some telepsychiatry, hearing moms in the kitchen clanking with pans and making comments like, come on, dinner is ready. I think it gave us opportunity to see our patients in their own environment. But yes, as you said, it was a mixed bag, I think. So we have a lot to learn. It certainly was very practical. And I think it helped many patients. So yes. I wish to thank you all one more time. And then Dr. Rolovich is going to conclude our meeting. I hope we'll see you next time.
Just going to repeat what you've said, Jasna, and just wonderful to have this gathering. Thank you all. Thank you, the Foundation of Princess Catherine, for giving us this opportunity. And I have a hope, a wish for all of us. And I would so much like for all of us to commit that next time we all meet, 2022 in June, and that we gather at that beautiful palace, and that we toast to each other, and that we do a follow-up session and see where we are a year later. Thank you all so much.
Thank you. Do vidjenia.
Do vidjenia.
Bye.
Bye.
Shalom.
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 Shalom.